Hi, I'm Alex Cunningham. I'm a USDA PPQ identifier at the Port of Miami, and I specialize in macrolepidoptera, especially neotropical noctuidae. Hello again, everybody. Now we're going to work together through the key on some various larvae so that we can actually find these characters. We're going to work off of what I call the Pessoa key, which is on page 189. This is following the key to frequently named lepidopteran larvae intercepted or potentially encountered at U.S. ports from Stephen Pessoa in 2014. And we're going to go through some noctuidae, sensu stricto, that you will commonly find, whether these are reportable or non-reportable, so that we can visually familiarize ourselves with this key. All right, so I'm going to try to read through this and find each thing. All right, so the first thing to do, as always, is place your caterpillar with the head to the left. Okay, make sure that your illumination is good for seeing seedy and seedal bases, and make sure that it's thoroughly submerged, so that you don't have a reflection off of emergent seedy or other characters. I'm just gonna set my paper clip down on this larva so it doesn't wiggle. Okay, and one reads, body with numerous secondary seedy or scoli, hiding most of the primary seedy. You see here we have very noticeable primary seedy only. Of course, it's not a bad idea to zoom in and make sure we don't have velvety small secondaries. Okay, on low magnification, we have a smooth cuticle here with seedy on pronounced panaculi. So that takes us to one prime, which is body without numerous short secondary seedy or scoli, and the primary seedy are evident. Okay, we're not going to go through the secondary seedy larvae today. Those are usually relatively easy as they have a lot of less subtle variation. So let's go to couplet 12. And this is whether caterpillars are living in a tent or case of plant or animal matter. Now, since this larva has just been provided to you, I will go ahead and tell you this was not in a tent or case. 12 prime. Which takes us to 13, and we're going to rule this out as well. If this larva was in a leaf mine, that would be a very thick leaf, and it was not. So 13 prime is caterpillars not living in a leaf mine. 14. Okay, now 14, it's time to get serious. So let's move to the middle of the larva and start counting abdominal segments, beginning behind the metathorax. So we have abdominal segment 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And the couplet reads, abdominal prolegs absent on A6. We clearly have the presence of a proleg on A6, which is 14 prime. Let's go to 15. Abdominal prolegs present only on A6 and A10. We do have a proleg back here on 10, but we also have them on 3, 4, 5, and 6. So 15 prime, that takes us to 16. Now it's time to zoom in on the presporacular group. This is a good time to stabilize the insect if yours is wiggly, or if it's curved in some way so that you can't look at it well. If you have a straight larva because of the foreleg, because of the legs, it should orient itself well for this. I'm going to zoom in as much as you can to make sure that you're looking at all of the seedy, that you're not missing a faint one. This larva has clearly marked seedal sockets. You see we're missing a seedy here. Well, we have the socket, but we don't have the actual hair coming off of it. Okay, now, I see two, but What do we need to always do to make sure we're looking at the right number of CD? That's right. We look at the other side. So I'm going to roll this over. Now, in this case, there's no question about which CD are pre-spiracular because they're right there in front. Here we have the exact same arrangement. We have two. Now, again, there's an empty cetal socket. This larva has been bumped around enough that it only has one, but we see if you look at other places on the insect, I'm going to slide him up so I can see the CD here above the spiracle and on the prothoracic shield. You see that clear ring of a cetal socket? That looks a lot like this empty socket on the pre-spiracular. Okay, just making sure that I'm not looking at some kind of other unique structure. So I'm going to roll back over. I like to reorient always with the lateral view of the head to the left here. Okay, so we have two. Two is definitely fewer than four. So 16 prime says less than four CD in the pre-spiracular group of the prothorax. We'll go to 17, which is whether we have three or less than three. Let's refocus. Again, we have two, which is less than three, which takes us to 18. Okay, now apparently only one ceta in the pre-spiracular group of the prothorax, or two ceta in the pre-spiracular group of the prothorax. Now a missing ceta does not count as apparently one. This is apparently two. So that takes us to 19. You'll notice in your key also, it's important, especially when looking at unusual commodities, that you read the paragraph below because Dr. Pessoa has left details in here that will take you to very specific commodity and origin descriptions. So sometimes you can rule something out. Like if this is on iris in Japan, that could be a specific genus, and then you're finished running through the key. But we're on 19, and now we go to this other critical character for the Noctuidae. We're going to look at the lateral CD of the abdomen. So I'm going to zoom out. We're looking at 3 to 6. So first, zoom out so that you can see the, in this case, lateral view of the proleg-bearing segments. And I see that they are similar in the cetal arrangement. So I'm going to zoom in. Here we have the two lateral CD. Okay, I'm looking here at abdominal segment 4. Here we have a ceta directly behind the spiracle and a ceta well below. And these are also very clearly, we started with this specimen because the panaculi and CD are obvious. And these are arranged in a backwards L with one behind and one well below. So there's no question as to whether these CD are positioned close together or on the same panaculum. This is Noctuidae. When you see this arrangement, you have a noctuoid. As 19 prime reads, ceta L1 and L2 of abdominal segments 3 to 6, widely separated, either both below the spiracle or one behind. That's an important thing to note. If they're well spaced but below, this could still be a noctuoid. Most of them, especially the Noctuidae sensu stricto, are one behind and one below, again making this L shape, if you imagine a right angle connecting the two. Now we can move all the way ahead to couplet 34. Okay, now in 34 we want to rule out Earius. In the case of Earius, you would have multiple dorsal CD with a fleshy filament that has a single terminal spine. For those of you looking at this online, you can find that on Image ID. There's a very good picture of Earius. And that would be from the Old World on cotton or one of the other Malvaceae. Okay, that's not the case here. We have one of these sort of everything else couplets. 34 prime reads dorsum of larvae without spiny fleshy filaments, SV group of thorax variable. Again, the rest of the couplet has some explanations of some of the more obscure families. There is a notodontidae and some nullidae can be ruled out here. All right, but this is a typical interception, so we'll go to 35. 35 reads, prolegs reduced or absent on A3 and or A4 compared to 5 and 6. In the noctuids, 5 and 6 are usually, when there is a difference in size, are usually the large prolegs. 35 prime reads, prolegs of A3 to A6 all equal in size. I want to note here that if you have a subtle size difference, that's not what we're looking for. We're looking for an evolutionary reduction or absence. And if you have prolegs which are not fully averted, you can roll it a little onto its back as I have here so that you can see the pair. These are certainly equal in size. I'll focus up on the top proleg. Okay, this isn't a pleuciine or an arebid with a proleg reduction. These are equal in size, which takes us to 38. This is the time to really make sure that your lighting, try to use, if you have a ring light versus a gooseneck, use that gooseneck. It's good now to get some lighting from the side. And for zooming in on the cuticle, I like to zoom in with the perspective from part of the dorsum. That gives me a perspective in on the side so that I can see the nature of the cuticular surface. See how this is now focused on to how the light is reflecting a little bit off of that dorsal surface. And at this time, use the maximum magnification of your zoom and focus up and down so you can travel across the surface as we are here. All right? And you're looking for a microscopic surface, okay? Now I see that this is either slightly granulose. I see little reflections off of a beaded surface here. It looks like this is at the very beginning of a molt, or I have a little separation of two layers of cuticle. But this is certainly not spiny. The only thing resembling a spine in any way here is a ceta. Oh, there it is. Okay, so we have a smooth cuticle. Very important that you're using the highest magnification. Until you become familiar with the cuticular surface of Lepidoptera larvae, it's easy to miss surface features on the cuticle. A larva that to the naked eye looks smooth can be very spiny under magnification. Okay, so we have a smoother granular cuticular surface here. This is not a heliothine. Let's go to couplet 40. In this key, we often rule out some of the more commonly intercepted genera in some of these couplets, and that's the case of number 40. We make sure we haven't got Elaphria. 40 reads, head with a characteristic thick longitudinal band, dorsal spots on A2, and this needs to be, if you do find those characters, from a shipment of pineapple, and it should be New World and Central American, or sometimes you might get this from Colombia or Northern Central America. This is not from pineapple. Also, of course, in mixed shipments, sometimes you might have a larva that is trying to find a place to pupate, so if there was pineapple anywhere around, there wasn't in this case. But let's look at the head. We have a mottled pattern here, and we do not have pale dorsal spots. These are more like hash marks or dashes. Okay, so this is not a Laphria. 40 prime. Larva lacks both a thick longitudinal band and dorsal spots on A2. 41. Very important character here. Very small and hard to find on larger larvae. This is something that shows up better on mid-instars. So if you have a medium-sized or small larva, this may be easier to find. It's also easier to find on larvae that have smaller panaculi. But we're going to look at the meso and metathorax, and we're going to look at the SDCD. This is still a good orientation for looking at the SDs, subdorsal CD. I'm going to focus in here. It's good to look at both together first and see that you have a similarity, and then you can kind of pick which one stands out. In this case, I like the look of the mesothorax. So I'm going to zoom in. And just for orientation here, I'll show you where we are. Up above here, we have the dorsal ceta. The D or dorsal ceta. And then here are our SDs, 1 and 2. Now, this is a case where you can see something that could be mistaken for a character that would be a tonofibrillary platelet. So this would say that mesothorax and metathorax lack a minute tonofibrillary platelet connected to the SDCD by a sclerotized bar, or mesothorax and metathorax with at least SD1, and sometimes SD2 connected to a minute tonofibrillary platelet by a sclerotized bar. I like to think of this as what it is for looking at it, because you can get a lot of variation. This is a muscle attachment, all right? If you have a spot or a dent in the area of the cetal socket, as we have here, in this case, SD2 is above, SD1 is below. This spot is well within the panaculum, and there is no structure connecting the two. This, however, does look like a muscle attachment. You see how there is a faint bar coming below, and it's hard to see without moving. It's always good to move the larva around and get another perspective and to zoom in and out. For the sake of demonstration, I'm holding still so you can see this. But this is a great example of that tonal fibrillary platelet. So we have one and not two. It shows up how they're different even more on the metathorax, okay? Now on larvae with smaller panaculi, this shows up even more. You see faintly a line coming below there. Okay. Also, I noticed while I was up here, we don't have a spiny cuticle, but just as a note while we're at this magnification, as I focus up and down here, mine does show a granular surface. That may come in handy as we come down to the species or genus level. I spent some time on that because that's a very important character whether you have one or two, and don't fool yourself without zooming in all the way that you have one or two without being really sure. It's also a good time to flip it over, look for a very clear and repeated pattern on the meso and metathorax. We'll go to 43. Okay, 43 reads, head with adfrontal area outlined in white, forming an inverted Y. Mandible with 4 scissorial teeth and no retinaculum. SD1 on T2 and T3 connected to the associated tonofibrillary platelet by a minute sclerotized bar. And we do have that. We have one. SV group bicetose on A1. Lateral spot often present on the mesothorax, and this spot there would be especially if you have a fresh larva, or A1, and body CD short, not much longer than the vertical height of the spiracle on A8. Now, we'll go through each of these characters, but I want to read 43 prime as well, so as we're going through them, we can see where we are or which to choose. Mesothorax and metathorax with both SD1 and SD2 connected to a minute tonal fibrillary platelet, that muscle attachment, by a sclerotized bar. Adfrontal area of head, often not white or pale. And larva lacks a swollen thorax or obvious dark lateral spots. Now I'm going to show another trick here for we'll first look at the head. If there's anything that's challenging with the pickled larva in liquid, it's to get a mug shot and look right in at its face. But in your watch glass, you can sometimes lean it up on the lip. I'm going to zoom out. See, I'm leaning up on the lip. Now this may come up out of the liquid, but we're going to look at a pretty obvious character. It wants to slide back down, so I'm going to put my stabilizer in here, hold it down with the paper clip. Now I'm going to lift, I'm going to bend it here with my forceps. And for this shot, I'm going to go ahead and hold it still and zoom up. All right, now we're getting some reflection here. This is on the side, but you should have it, to stay with this first part of the couplet, a Y with a pale line coming down the middle and then splitting down both sides of the adfrontal area. I see a Y clearly. I'm going to move it to the middle. It's a really good example of the adfrontal Y shape. Okay, so we have one of those characters. We'll do the mandible in a moment, but let's move to some of the other large things. We've already looked at the tonofibrillary platelet. We have one. The subventral group should be bicetose on A1. We don't have a big obvious lateral spot here. And we'll also look at the length of the CD. Okay, so let's come into A1, keeping the paper clip in place. Now again, subventrals are on the outer side of the base of a proleg. A1 doesn't have a proleg, so we have to imagine where it would be. Can you see the ventral ceta? There is the ventral ceta for orientation. All right, there are two of them. We're looking at both. No proleg here, but that blank space is where that would be. We have a large ceta and a small ceta here. This is the bicetose subventral group. So we do have two. Okay, so this is looking more like 43 than 43 prime. But let's be sure, and because we have, in this case, a large larva, this is a good time to demonstrate, or if you're not familiar with doing this, to practice a mandibular dissection. Or for opening up a mandible, I often like to use a pin that's just bent slightly at the tip, or if you have a probe that's been dropped by a helper that is a little bent, that makes a nice hook. Another way is to use your forceps. The most important thing is to not worry about damaging the specimen. We're going to find another character, so we're going to make the specimen better. Sometimes you'll be able to get the mandible, the jaws, to open enough. We want to look at the inner surface, and sometimes you'll have to remove it. This is probably the strongest muscle on a caterpillar and the most sclerotized structure. Most important thing is to try not to break it. So if you are using two forceps like I am here, the part you want to manipulate will be toward the base of the mandible rather than the outer part, which would break it. And it's best to look for the inner surface of the mandible. It's best to have it complete. So what I'm going to do with the example of two pairs of forceps here, in this case I have a curved pair and a straight pair. These aren't as sharp as I would like, but what I'm going to do is I'm going to stabilize it, really smashing the thoracic segments here, and I'm going to nudge my forceps in below the mandibles. It's holding really firmly. You'll see this if you have an earlier instar, that's fine. You'll still see this. And I'm just letting go to let the spring of the forceps spread the mandibles. Okay, now this is cooperating nicely. You don't need to have both. It's good to look at both for comparison, but we're looking for a very obvious structure on the face of the mandible. Once you have that open, it's good to orient it now so you can look right down in to the mandibular surface, the inner mandibular surface. Okay, this cooperated beautifully. Once you've got that, zoom in all the way. You want to look at the inner surface of the mandible. Lateral lighting is good here too, because you want, if you can, to get a little reflection and see whether you have a smooth inner surface. You don't want backlighting here. You want to see if you have a smooth surface or if you have an obvious character, which would be a retinaculum. We'll see that in another specimen later, but a retinaculum would be an inner tooth or molar on the middle of this surface here, and it will be very sclerotized. Okay, this is smooth surface. In this view, you can also see the teeth. Okay, and scissorial teeth are just big triangles. 1, 2, 3, 4. This last edge along the top, we're not really counting that as a scissorial tooth. It's a cutting surface, but we have very clearly these 4 scissorial teeth. Okay, this is Spidoptera. We've got enough that we found. The last thing you can do to make sure is look at the body CD. Spidoptera usually has a tall spiracle on A8 there. And if you look at surrounding CD, rarely will those CD be notably longer than the length, than the height of that spiracle. This is close, but that's similar, okay? You'll have on non-Spidoptera, other groups, you'll have considerably longer ceta there. Now, unlike the simplified version that we went through earlier in this workshop, this key includes some of the major Spidoptera. So let's go ahead and see if we can figure out which Spidoptera we have, okay? If you have something small enough that you have a noticeable bulge of the prothorax, Spidoptera is not a genus that's good for guessing, and it's perfectly fine to say that you have Spidoptera SP. Of course, if you have a later instar, as I have here, it would be great if this is a non-reportable species, so we don't have to fumigate anything. The first point says small larvae defined by the swollen thorax, Spidoptera SP. You're finished. That's a great IDA to get. Let's say that this came from cut flowers from South America. Okay, so this is not on orchids from Thailand. Unfortunately, some of the most characteristic things on a Spidoptera has to do with coloration. And when you have a very pale specimen, paler than this, you have to kind of use your imagination and just look for lighter and darker areas. Okay, Spidoptera latura usually has a green to yellow brown to dark blue gray ground color and a subdorsal area that will not contrast with a paler dorsum. Okay, here we have a darker dorsum and a subdorsal line that's paler. That doesn't seem to be the case. This is very important with latura. The spiracular stripe, which is how we're describing the lateral stripe here, okay, because it includes the spiracles, there would be a marked spiracular stripe interrupted by a black band or spot on A1. A1 is a frequent location on Spidoptera for a large black spot. Now, if there are dorsal triangles, as you often have on Spidoptera, you'll have a pattern of triangles. Usually in this area, the triangle will be pointing toward the center, and very frequently on the terminal segments, we don't have that, but those have an apical white dot in latura. It stands out very well even when it's pale. And abdominal spiracles usually with a large black dot dorsally and a white spot posteriorly. And if I would have read ahead fast enough, that's asking if this would be old world. We already established that this is New World. Literalis is an olive green or brown or sometimes gray background. Subdorsal area usually strongly contrasting with a paler dorsum. No, we have a darker dorsum and a lighter subdorsal area. Something that we do have agreement with is that the spiracular stripe is not interrupted on A1 by a spot or black band. And if there are dorsal triangles, they would be on all segments. We don't have any. And no apical white dot. We don't have triangles. Again, though, that literalis is an old world and European pest. Now, these next two are common, are usual suspects that often lack the large dark spots and triangles. Mesothoracic lateral dark spot normally present near SD1, although I would say I often encounter them without these spots. Large lateral spot on A1 absent, okay? Dorsum often contrasting with the darker subdorsal area and colored with an irregular series of white dots and broken lines. More rarely, a series of paired thin black dashes are present. Cosmopolitan polyphagus. If we look at the next thing also, this should also say cosmopolitan polyphagus, but dorsal abdominal panacula larger than the diameter of the spiracles on A1 to 7. Conspicuous on A8 and 9. Abdominal segments with a granulated texture under magnification of 25 or greater. Now we did see a hint of that. Also, most Spidoptera have small panaculae. These, if I zoom back in here, are similar in size to the spiracle. When that happens, you should be wondering if you have Spidoptera frugiperda, okay? If you have these big panaculae, we walked through all of those things, but if you have one muscle attachment rather than two, and then you have the panaculae similar to or a little larger in size than the spiracle, then it's a great idea to look in very closely at the cuticle. Okay, I'm trying to see here if I can see these beads there through the transparent outer cuticle, but I think we saw it best on the prothorax. There we go. This is a slightly granular cuticle. Okay, so I think this is frugiperda. Okay, another good character just to confirm that this is frugiperda is to look directly down on the prolegs at the arrangement of the musculature beneath. And what we're looking for is a little pattern that is characteristic in frugiperda where there is a Y. And the Y often has little hash marks, as you see down the center here, okay, connecting that. And then you'll get two branches coming up on either side as well. There's hash marks down the center, and then the branches of a Y. And especially if you have a fresher specimen, this should show up. There it is again, all right. Here we see the upper leg of the Y at the base of the prolegs. All right, there's another view. All right, so we've keyed out our first species using this. Now it's enough, I mean it's certainly progress already just to know that you have Spidoptera. There also is a good, there are good images on Lep Intercept, and in the owlet moths of North America you can see great photos of live and fresh specimens. I'm going to make a quick comment on boiling larvae. These larvae have all been boiled. You will lose some color right away, but since we use isopropanol instead of ethyl alcohol, specimens will often blacken. So when you receive a specimen, it's good to, I heat some water in the microwave in a crucible, but get a little bit of water boiling and just drop the larva in there for 5 to 10 seconds. And this is also crucial if you're gonna send the specimen up so that By the time the specialist receives the specimen, or especially if it's a routine that's sitting for some time, that it isn't completely blackened. Okay, now we're gonna switch specimens. Let's go ahead and mount it laterally, and if it's too wobbly, drop your paper clip on them. Now wherever this, just like Frugiperda is important wherever you are, this organism is important wherever you are, even if you don't intercept it, because there's been such a to-do. We're gonna start again at the beginning of the key, but we can go fairly quickly forward, all right, because do we have primary CD only, or are there secondary CD on this? We have only primary CD, okay? And I'll just be the imaginary associated information. This came from Mexico on celery, all right? And it's not in a leaf mine then, and we don't have it in a tent, or it's not in a case of plant or animal material. Okay, so we can move all the way to couplet 14 and make sure that you have your specimen submerged. Head to the left. Let's lay this out and look at the abdominal prolegs. See if we have any marked reduction, and then also where the prolegs are present. To rule out the gracilarids, and of course this would be one of the world's largest, we want to look to make sure that we have a proleg on A6. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Proleg is present on A6. 15. Abdominal prolegs present only on A6 and 10, which would be what family? Geometridae. We have many more prolegs than two pairs. So we're on couplet 16. Let's go into the presporacular group and see if we have fewer CD than 4. This side looks like 2. I'm zooming in from the top. And this side, they're both broken off, but I have 2 on both sides. So we have fewer than 4. We have fewer than 3. So we went from 16 to 17, now to 18. We have 2 CD in the presporacular group of the prothorax. So the next group then, what CD do we want to look at as soon as we've confirmed the prethoracic? We want to look at the LCD. Okay, so zoom out. Get nicely focused on your abdominal spiracles. Make sure that you see a regular and repeated pattern, which I see here. We have one above, one behind, and one below. So I can zoom in on a segment. The LCD are far apart with one behind and one well below the spiracle. So what superfamily is this? Noctuidae. All right, they're widely separated. We go all the way to couplet number 34. So for 34, we wanna see if we have fleshy filaments coming off some of the dorsal or lateral CD to rule out aereus on pineapple, which we do not have. So we go to 35 and look for a reduction of prolegs. Okay, I did a lot of skipping. Okay, let's go to 35 here. Now see, this is what happens when you know what you have. In 35, we're looking for reduced prolegs, okay? So let's go ahead and zoom out and look at the prolegs on A3, 4, 5, and 6. In the specimen that we have here, do these look like we have a reduction, or do these look like they're the same size? These are equal in size, okay? That's an easy one to get past, unless you're in the shadowy areas of slight reduction, but these are obviously the same size, okay? So we go to 38. 38 takes us to the cuticle. Okay, so again, to find a good view of the cuticle, zoom in all the way and get a nice view where it shows half of the organism, and focus up and down along the surface. Now in this line, the horizon sort of this landscape, you focus very well on that line, you can get a good view of the cuticular surface which would give you the silhouette of spines if they were there. This is a perfectly smooth cuticle, not even granular, all right? From 38, we then go to 38 prime, which takes us to 40 with a smooth cuticle. Now we're looking for the characteristic thick longitudinal band and dorsal spots of a Lafria on pineapple, which we don't have. So we're at 41, and this is the couplet I was so eager to get to. Mesothorax and metathorax lack a minute tonofibrillary platelet connected to the SDCD biosclerotized bar, or mesothorax and metathorax with at least SD1 and SD2 connected to a minute tonofibrillary platelet connected by a sclerotized bar, okay, which we demonstrated. Again, we have it on both. When you have it on both, it's already time to start suspecting copatarsia. Okay, here we have the dorsal seta and SD2 and SD1, okay? Dorsal, it's out of view there. There's dorsal, SV2, SV1. Now, even at this magnification, I can see that it's more than a simple socket. There's something below. If we zoom all the way in on these two CD, there's a dark area below and a dark area below. And especially on the lower one here, I see a little line. Okay, this is a muscle attachment. The tonofibrillary platelet is an internal platelet to which muscle is attached. Okay, we have it on two, both SD2 and SD1. It's already time to begin. If this is foreign cargo, this is time to suspect copatarsia. So 43 though will be works whether we have one or we have two. If you have the presence of that, we go to 43. Okay, now we want to know whether or not we have Spidoptera. First thing we're going to look at is the face. If you stabilize this thing and grab the thorax and twist your forceps a little so we can get a head-on view. Let me focus. We do not have a clear adfrontal Y. We have a concolorous blotched head, but the Y of Spidoptera shows up very well when it does. Let's look at some other Spidoptera characters to see. SD1 on T2 and T3 connected to the associated tonal fibrillary platelet by a minute sclerotized bar. Only one. Okay, we don't even have to go through all of those other characters because we very clearly have two. So 43 prime, mesothorax and metathorax with both SD1 and SD2 connected to a minute tonal fibrillary platelet by a sclerotized bar. You can even put copatarsia question mark by 43 prime because that's where we're going. We want to rule that out. Also, you can rule out your other Spidoptera characters like that swollen thorax or big lateral spots on the thorax or on A1. Okay, we don't have any such thing. 44. Okay, now we're going to look at another important character we haven't seen since the morphology section. We're going to look at the spinneret. I'm really glad that was shown, and if you're watching this video and you haven't gone over the morphology, I really recommend it. It'll show you all of these things that are so helpful for orientation, especially on these later instar larvae. The spinneret is very small because, of course, silk is very fine. I'm going to see if I can tease it out so we can see it from the side. The reason for this is that Peridroma saucea also has the two muscle attachments. Okay, it has some other characteristic things, but an extremely characteristic spinneret. It would be spined, whereas most spinnerets are spatulate or rounded or lobed. And I'm going to go ahead and point it out here. We're also going to talk later about the labial palpi and how long the terminal segment is. This is short and stubby. This is the spinneret, this little plate. So if you can get your larva on its side or on its back so you can tease that out, and for demonstration or looking at it yourself, especially with very fine forceps, it's okay to remove that. It's okay to remove that and look at it all by itself. But you will find keys for other Lepidoptera larvae that ask you to look at the spinneret. And really, it's usually not even a dissection. It's just a matter of orienting it and teasing the thing out. Now, I'm going to try to point it out here. Okay, so you have the mandible here. Oops. And the labial palpi. Okay, hypopharynx is here in the middle. And below that, this clear structure, if I can hold steady, that's the spinneret. I'm going to come in. This is the highest magnification I can get on this scope, but I'm going to see if I can tease it out with the pin. Teasing it out, by that I mean go above it and push down. It'll come down a little bit. And the best way to see it is to get the silhouette against the back. Usually this works best with a light background. So I'm going to push down on this. If this had spinules, you would see sharp, elongate spines almost kind of forming a W inside. This one, mine is small and rounded. You'll see it either rounded like this, or you'll see that it is slightly spatulate. Okay, now it's focused on the outer edge. This is rounded. Right there at the tip of my pointer. Okay, so we spent some time on that because that's our first time looking at the spinneret. This spinneret lacks apical spinules, okay? And also, we don't have, another thing a Lafria will have is very black spiracles. We have a dark boundary, sort of a typical dark boundary, but by black spiracles, it means that that whole area would be dark. So we go to 45, and 45 is usually Copatarsia, but we want to make sure that we rule out other things because there are some oddballs that could come out this far in the key. Spinneret rounded or with a medial depression, that's what I called spatulate, yes. Labial palpi with last segment much shorter than the basal segment, all right? Let's go to the labial palpus. Now that we've looked at the spinneret, these palpi are nice and big and easy to look at. If you look at the labial palpi, the basal segment is large and the terminal segment short and stubby, okay? Mature larvae, and mine is a mid-late instar here, have white body CD, light or pale, okay? Paired dorsal dashes or triangles, lateral red spots, or no markings. That's fun. Young larvae have a mottled head, dark seedy, and the prolegs might be reduced on those. Mottled head is a great character, okay? Here's the modeling, okay? And this is what's being referred to as dashes, are sort of these pale spots on, or the pale background with a dark foreground. And let's look at what our commodities might be for this. Cut flowers and vegetables, most often from Mexico, Northern South America, and Chile. Okay, and we said this was on Mexican vegetables, all right? So this is Copatarsia, all right? And while we're here, I'm gonna zoom out. We're gonna look at a couple others. Okay, here's a little shriveled guy coming into the area here that's strange, but it has this stripe modeling on the head. Here is a big one coming in. All right, much more typical here. But when they're green, you'll see a white or pale lateral or spiracular stripe, and it'll be dark green up above here. Okay, but even on this big guy, I can see those muscle attachments there, all right? A mottled head, the modeling is faded because to the top here because this is a last instar, all right? There's a broken mandible there that shows that it's got no retinaculum. Okay, so that's Copatarsia. So go ahead and set that aside and we're gonna do another noctuid here. We're gonna do something a little different. You can go ahead and turn back to 14 because that's where I'm going to start on this. All right, so we have another larva here. With this kind of larva, or a larva in this orientation, usually it doesn't want to orient itself anything but laterally. So it's good to have two pairs of forceps, also something like the paperclip I have here to stabilize it in case we need to rearrange things. We have only primary setae, all right? Many of the setae are knocked off of my specimen. There they are showing up. We have simple panaculi. We don't have secondary setae. And we have an organism that was not in a tent or a case or a leaf mine. So we'll go straight to couplet 14. We always want to make sure that we are carefully counting prolegs, all right? Now here, for the first time, we have something with an unusual proleg set, all right? So mine's so long that I have to move back and forth. Also, when you're counting these, be careful, because some of these organisms have elongated or shortened abdominal segments. It's always good to start right at the meso or the metathorax and start counting. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, okay? 7, 8, 9, 10. Do we have prolegs on segment 6? We have them on 5 and 6 and 10. So there's the next thing, to rule out or include geometridae. We're ruling it out because we have prolegs on which segment? That geometrids never have prolegs on segment 5. Exactly. Always on 6 or often on 6, usually on 6 and 10, but not on 5. Here we have 5. So we're at 16. We want to rule out Langsfordia, which is one of the unusuals that has 4 presporacular setae. So do we have less than 4? Or do we have less than 3? We have 2. 2 presporaculars, the most familiar condition in Noctuidae, particularly pale and thin. So we have to find our spiracle. Where is it? Here's a spiracle. Now this is oriented a little bit on its back. I don't want to look at this panaculum below, but the one directly in front of it. But what's nice about this is that with this backlighting, I see very clearly two. A little thin. Now you can imagine how hard that would be to see if it were clear. But we have 2. And if you want to, be sure, of course, you're going to flip the specimen over and look at that exact same spot. Make sure you don't have 3. So we have less than 4, less than 3. We're down to couplet 18, which is to make sure it's not only apparently 1. We have obviously 2. Even though 1 is tiny, it's definitely a seta. 18 prime is 2 seta. Let's go to 19. 19 is confirmation of the superfamily Noctuidae. The arrangement of the abdominal L seta. Okay. Now in other specimens we had very obvious seta. These are much more subtle. We have to look carefully. Okay. There's one missing. We want to see if our lateral setae are paired, often on the same panaculum. Let me try to move this. If they're paired on the same panaculum or close together, or if they're widely separated. Okay, there's a spiracle. Okay, so here's a spiracle. There's one setae behind it and one well below. These are widely separated. We have a noctuoid. Okay, 34 reels out is to rule out Abelsmachus or hibiscus pest, Earius on Malvaceae. We'll go to 35. 35 is about proleg reduction. Okay, that's very important here. Prolegs reduced or absent on A3 and A4 compared to A5 and A6. Okay. In this case, they're absent. It's very obviously that condition. Okay? So now we're starting to suspect, well, now we see we have a looper. We have a noctuid that is missing some prolegs, or they're very reduced. So we go to 36. Seed of V1 on A2 modified into a ring-like structure or not. A1 and A2. Now this is handy because it's twisted just a little bit. So I can come in all the way on the ventral CD. And what I'm looking for is to see if I have something like a sclerotized ring. Okay, on A1 and 2. Okay, there they are. They're the ventral CD. They're regular CD. That's not the case. So we're at 37. We already suspect a pleuciine. We're going to confirm that by confirming it's a noctuid, which should have a biserial mesoseries of crochets. Okay, so it should be biordinal, or sometimes it's weakly biserial. Okay, and so if you look at the prolegs here all the way out, this is clearly a biordinal group of crochets. 37 prime gives us the option of clearly uniordinal and uniserial. So if you have a looper that has crochets in a uniordinal or uniserial mesoseries, that's probably one of the arabids, okay? But we have a pleuciine here. I highly recommend when you find pleuciines to use the key, as we did with Spidoptera, in this same larger key. We're not going to go all the way through that right now, but what we are going to look for is the most important character in that key. Since I have more than one specimen here, let's see if we can find a vestigial proleg. Okay, the vestigial proleg is really vestigial, okay? It's very, very small, however it's present. Or it's going to be present or absent, but it's going to, when it's present, it's very small. This is another thing that it's very important to have a boiled specimen for, because you want it to be everted. And the way to know that you're in the right place for a vestigial proleg is to look for those subventral setae, because they should sort of frame the outer edge of where the proleg would have been. All right, I like to have this in a lateral arrangement so I can see the profile. Okay, so it's a little nub or nipple. Don't think that you're going to find something with crochets. I'm gonna zoom back out so we know where we are, okay? I'm on 1, 2, 3, okay? Here is a subventral seta. And here is a beautiful, and there's another lovely vestigial proleg, all right? These can be very elusive. Look thoroughly and carefully to see if you have that, okay? In this case, this organism is Trichoplusia ni. One of the first things you look for once you're sure that you have a pleuciine is that vestigial proleg. Okay, we're gonna straight away go to our last practice through the key. This time you're going to be presented with two specimens. And I invite you, as we go through the key, to focus first on one or the other, and it doesn't matter which. Also, please, anything that you think, like another way of phrasing something, or if there's a character like the Y muscle attachment that was poorly demonstrated on my specimen, if you find something that's a character that seems to be reliable for you, especially on things you see a lot of, please share that with the rest of us. I'll test it to see if it's valid. It's always nice to find another term or another character. Okay, now, to a point, these two larvae are going to key the same way. Okay, so here we have a noctuid larva. We know that because we do not have secondary setae. Our proleg arrangement is on 3, 4, 5, and 6, and 10. We have a bicetose presporacular group. Okay, while I'm looking in close at this, there are a couple things that come up. We have a spiny cuticle here, okay? Also, This is missing one seed on this side. We'll look at the other side. You see there's a socket toward the back, but also these are arranged horizontally, which is a little unusual. It's something I noticed right away, because when we have two, they're usually vertical. The back, there's a little socket here at the back in the dark area and a larger one there. Quickly, I'm going to look at the other side. Make sure that your specimen has two CD in its presporacular group. There we go. They both, now in this case, the smaller hind seed is attached, and see it's very thin. Okay. Also, confirming we have a Noctuidae, there's a meso series of crochets that are biordinal. Okay. Prolegs are also equal in size. And so that we can go straight to couplet 35, these large pinnaculi on the meso and metathorax lack an internal muscle attachment or tonofibrillary platelet, okay? In this case, these pinnaculi could be called callosi. So if we're at 35, we don't have a reduction or absence of prolegs on A5 or A6. We sort of cut to the chase that we have a Noctuidae here. They're equal in size, so we'll go straight to 38. 38 characterizes the cuticle. Now, stay focused on one of the two specimens that you have here in the class. Both of them will have a spiny cuticle. Again, it's good to get a view that shows the dorsum, so that you can get the silhouette of the spines, all right? In fact, it can even be very helpful, as you'll see later, to get it so that you can see whether or not the pinnaculum is spined. Okay, but here as I move up and down, see a very clearly thorny, spiny cuticle at high magnification. Remember to zoom all the way in. That takes us to 39, and that involves the arrangement of the prothoracic, the presporacular group on the prothorax. When you see a spiny cuticle and you know you have a Noctuidae, you're already starting to wonder if you have a heliothine, which is the subfamily of Helicoverpa and Chloridia and others. But a great giveaway to confirm that is the arrangement of the presporacular group. They should be horizontally arranged as they are, or slightly diagonal. Almost everything else has a vertical arrangement. This will only work for a late instar. Spines show up on earlier instars, but the presporacular group doesn't migrate into this horizontal arrangement until later. So we know we have a heliothine. Now, to find out which it is, keep the one that you've got and practice your evil dentistry of mandibular dissection. Either remove a mandible or pry the jaw open, whichever works best, and arrange your scope so that you can see the inner surface. Okay? And then I have this pried open already enough to see a smooth inner surface. Again, another trick for mandibular dissections is to have a micro hook that's from a probe or a pin with only the tip bent. Very firmly hold the thorax down of the organism on its back. Get the forceps in under what would be a chin. And one mandible will always lay on top of the other, and oftentimes that top one is going to pop out first. And either spread them, or as I'm going to do here, to remove it, especially for a photograph, if like you want to send it up for confirmation, make sure you grab at the base and not the tip. It's better to tear everything apart, as I've done here, than to break the mandible, all right? I'm going to tease this off. Okay, see how I've broken the entire head apart? I'm not worried about it. I've already looked at all the characters that are needed there. They're present. But I want to lay this mandible out in the open so that I can look in at the inner surface. This is smooth. Since I've looked at that and I see that that's smooth, to identify what this is, smooth goes with smooth, okay? And teeth go with teeth. It's something to remember with these heliothines. So here I have this. Now, with the same specimen you've dissected, come in on the panaculi on A1 and A2 and arrange them as I have here so that you are looking at their profile. You should have panaculi that are smooth. See that the spines do not continue up to the tip of the panaculum. You may have some spines around the perimeter, but if I move this around, all of the panaculi are naked. Okay? And now that you've had a little practice, let's look at the other specimen in the same. Now, some of you have got the other one already dissected. Look at the mandible here. And this looks a little bit open, so it's possible I'll already be able to see the character I want to find. Before the threat of Old World bollworm, we looked at this a lot less because both were natives that we would find on native commodities. See, I'm prying this open to see if I can get the inner surface. That should be open enough for an orientation to look down in on top. Okay, and I am. This is the retinaculum. It is as if there is a miniature mandible mounted in the center of the mandible. That is often along the ridge or in between the ridges of the second tooth. Okay? Now this can sometimes wear down, and when this wears down, you'll still see where it originated, all right? But this is the retinaculum. Now, smooth goes with smooth and spiny goes with spiny. I think of the retinaculum as a feature of a spinier and less smooth creature. You'll see that when the retinaculum is present, that the spines on the cuticle tend to be longer and less even. You'll also have some pale ones. But most importantly, if you look at the specimen that you had with a retinaculum and get those calzi into perspective for the profile, they are also spiny. This is Chloridia, formerly Heliothus. You'll also see spines on the terminal panaculi. I think of Helicoverpa as velvety and of Chloridia as spiky. But the first thing to look for is that retinaculum right away. And you'll find those characters are in the heliothyne key that's in this, also on LEP intercept. So now you've keyed out some very important noctuids that are larvae.